I need to reset the timer here, so I will get out from the side view.
Sure. Yeah. So I will hold up sheets so
for a minute. Okay.
5 minutes and take 10 minutes before the thing is done. So are you going to need all the time, or will there be some time left at the end for questions?
I think only 5 minutes will be left.
5 minutes.
I wish I can do it a bit faster.
Okay, no, that's great.
Okay, so welcome back, everyone. I hope you all enjoyed your lunch break. And we're starting off the afternoon with Bora Tunca from SoundCloud. He's going to talk about the BFF pattern in action. Bora, thank you.
Hi, thank you all. Welcome. So this talk will be about our architecture, the microservices that SoundCloud is running, how our architecture is evolved, and what technologies and solutions that we picked up along the way. So first of all, I will introduce myself. My name is Bora. I joined SoundCloud 2 years and a half ago. I started there as a JavaScript engineer. I did work on the front end. Then I moved on to working on our client-specific APIs. And most recently, a year ago, I moved to a core services team where we built the microservices that are the basic building blocks of our business features. So I will talk about SoundCloud very briefly. It is the self-claimed largest online audio distribution platform. We have a huge variety of creators on our platform, and they upload around 12 hours of audio every minute. And with that said, we can move to our architecture. No one's surprised, SoundCloud started as a monolithic Ruby on Rails application. And after some years of growth in user base, we had to switch to another architecture, which was microservice architecture. And at the point when we did this decision, our architecture looked like this. We had a couple of client applications that included our own applications like our website, iOS and Android applications, and our embedded player. And also we had plenty of third-party applications that are working on top of SoundCloud. And then we had this huge code base, which we called Mothership internally. It was our monolithic application. And all those client applications were talking to Mothership code base through our public API, which was an embedded layer in our code base. So then we started writing our first generation of microservices. And when we created them, there were only a handful of those. And the most convenient point to integrate them to our architecture was, again, our public API layer. So we did this integration, and this is how we actually started our microservices journey. And the next thing happened is that we started writing even more microservices. At the very beginning, we were curious about how this transition will go and how will it affect our lives as the engineers of the company, our day-to-day tasks. Around the time when we write like about 20 microservices or so, we really got the hang of it. We loved it because it gave us the freedom that we never had before. We were free to choose our technology stack, our patterns, our frameworks that we want to work with, and they were all greenfield projects, so we were able to iterate faster without having futile discussions and so on. So we loved it. Then, of course, we continued writing more microservices. Around the time where we had 60 to 80 microservices, I think honeymoon was over at this time because now we started hitting the problems of scale. So those problems are sometimes organizational, but also some of them were like, we never had any visibility of what microservices were running on production. Like, it already sounds scary enough, like there were services running. We didn't know actually which services are doing what operations, because like every team, of course, knew the microservices that they own and they talked to, but the rest of the world was kind of a black box, so they didn't have the visibility of what's going on there. And also, at this time, we didn't have a really clear vision of how we structure our microservices. So our production environment was more like a dumping area for the microservices. We create them and put them there, and everyone was talking to everyone else. So it was a bit chaotic at first time. So of course, as we start hitting those problems, we start looking for solutions. And I want to talk about one solution that we adopted over the last year, and we still use it, and it became kind of an important tool for our engineering organization, and that's why I want to talk about that solution. It is described as Humane Registry in this article. So the problems that we were trying to address with Humane Registry were twofold. First of all, we wanted to have this visibility that I mentioned. We wanted to know what microservices are there, how many microservices we are running, which teams are owning them. And that is actually related to the second point. The second problem that we have, it was really hard to find the ownership of the microservices because teams were creating microservices for a specific feature, they put it on production, and then their focus shifts to another area. And this microservice staying on production, it's getting production traffic, but no one is actively maintaining it. And to make things work, if you want to make a change on this microservice, then it takes a really long time to find the people with the right knowledge and the right historical context about this microservice. So you need this data in order to start making changes on a microservice that is already on production. So this article actually describes building a tool that answers this kind of problems. And it has three main guiding principles. First one is that it should be oriented around people. The reason of this principle is that most of the time the questions that we are looking answers for are related to people. So we have a microservice and we want to change something on it. And what we are thinking, or the questions that we ask are usually who created this microservice, who did the most of the contributions. This is the person who probably knows the most of the internal implementation details of the code base. Who did the latest contribution? That is the person who knows the recent activity on this code base. And also, who deployed this microservice, how often it is deployed, who handled the latest incident on this microservice, how often those incidents happen, and also who closed the latest story that involved some kind of work on this microservice. So all those problems there, or questions, they are related to people. That's why the tool that we want to build should be oriented around people. And the second guiding principle is that even though it is oriented around people, it shouldn't rely on people to stay up to date. So this information that we want to keep in this tool can get out of sync very quickly. And we shouldn't expect people to get it up to date manually, because people are already busy and engineers are not famous for keeping the documentation up to date. So there should be another way of keeping this information up to date. And that is also described in the article. It says that there are so many data sources available to your organization internally. So examples are your code bases, version control system, your deployment tools, your issue tracking. So those tools can answer some of the questions that I mentioned earlier. And also like your on-call schedules, your application logs, your HR tool. And so you can get the contact details and the teams that they belong to. And so by regularly aggregating data from this kind of data sources, you can create a valuable information. And then the third principle is that you need to present this information in a human readable form, because our audience is humans again, and it should be human readable and it should be available to them. And finally, even though we do not rely on people to stay to keep this information up to date, we should encourage them to contribute to itself, because most of the times the most important piece of information about the services that you're running are living in the minds of your engineers. So when they want to write this down, they should be enabled to do so. We should enable them to do so. So services directory, we call the name of this tool, and we built this tool. It has been used about a year. It looks like this. It gives us the microservices that we are running. So all of them, their visibility is available. Then it gives us which teams are running, what microservices, and what dependencies each microservice has. So this has been quite valuable for us. And then, as I said, this tool has been the central hub for sharing and spreading knowledge around our microservices within our company. And we are even today, we have projects to improve those tools and add more integrations, because the more we invest in this tool, the more important it becomes for us. So I will get back to, Service Directory was one solution, and now I will get back to our architecture. So this was the state of affairs when we left off. And then on top of this, we started writing more microservices, and of course, this architecture didn't hold true for a long time. There were plenty of reasons why we wanted to move away from this architecture. I will mention two of them. First one is, whenever you need to add a new microservice, you have to touch the mothership code base, change it, and implement your integration and deploy it, which is something that we didn't want to do. And second thing is that we wanted to move away from using our own public API, especially from our own clients, like from our iOS and Android application. We didn't want to rely on our own public API. The reason is that public API is a one-size-fits-all solution. It works quite well for the third-party applications because you don't know their use cases, so you give them a general use case API, and they should be happy with it. But for our own use cases, we know that our clients have specific requirements, and we know what those requirements are. And we can actually create APIs that is specific to those requirements. And by using public API, we actually have to make trade-off on the user experience, because public API doesn't support all of the use cases that we have. That's why we wanted to move away from this architecture. So we created client-specific APIs, and we created an API dedicated to each of the clients we have. Their responsibility is to go to the microservices land, fetch the necessary data, and then tailor it according to the needs of their specific client, and then serve this data back to the client. So one interesting thing we did at this point is that you see this mothership codebase, it sits next to other codebases. We started treating our mothership codebase as a microservice, even though it was a huge codebase and had plenty of other capabilities. The way we accessed the functionality on mothership codebase wasn't different than the way we accessed the functionality on any of our microservices. So we made this change, and it actually made our architecture simpler. So we didn't need to think about if this functionality is in mothership or is it somewhere else. So it was, from the point of a client-specific API, it was all the same. This functionality was living somewhere in the microservice. So we like to name things. So we stole the name of Edge layer from Netflix, and we put it there. So this layer made up of our client-specific APIs, we called it Edge layer. And on the other layers, we weren't creative, so we went with the regular names. And then another naming we did here was giving a specific name to our client-specific APIs, which was BFF, standing for backend for frontend. So this approach of using client-specific APIs wasn't something new. We were heavily inspired by the Netflix's architecture, and they were using that on production at the time. And also, to my knowledge, Twitter has something similar as well. So my main point is, because we gave this specific name, and we kind of rebranded it and marketed it well, it became kind of famous. So, for example, it showed on the technology radar of ThoughtWorks, and so many external developers and external people and companies, they have shown a lot of interest in our architecture. So one funny lesson we learned from is that rebranding an existing idea and kind of marketing and selling it back to the people were kind of the key to getting recognition for SoundCloud engineering. So with that, I will move on to our architecture, and we will have another look. So if you put our microservices in the heart of the universe, the next thing that comes is our BFF applications. They are the border between the outside world, our client applications and our happy clients, and then our microservices. So every request that ends up in our microservices land has to go through one of our BFF applications. So that was the main point of this architecture. So because those BFFs, they sit on the perimeter, we expect them to execute some set of operations, some certain set of operations for each incoming request. And now I will take one single BFF application, and we will investigate its production behavior. So request arrives to a BFF. What happens next is in two folds again. The very first step is what I call gathering the contextual data around this incoming request. This includes this set of operations that I mentioned earlier. And those are actually getting the user session data, detecting the geolocation of the incoming request, and also figuring out what business features this request has access to. So we are doing this very first step because we know that this bundled this information that we bundle with the incoming request is really important for the microservices that we're going to reach on the second step. So what happens is that those are all implemented as microservices again. So what happens is that BFF is talking to each of those microservices. It gathers this response data from each of them, and then this response data is bundled with the incoming request. On the second step, we send this request and the bundled information together with the to the microservices. So we are doing this very first step because we know that this information is necessary for the functionality of the microservices we have on the second step. So if we haven't done that, what would have happened is that we would request a proxy the coming request to a microservice, then it would probably need to fetch this data manually by itself. And now nowadays we have our BFF applications, they talk to multiple microservices, not only one, so this operation would have happened again and again. So what we are trying to do here is to cut down the number of RPCs happening between our microservices, because every RPC that is happening within the lifecycle of a single incoming request is adding up to our overall latency. So we want to shave some milliseconds from this overall latency. So we go with this approach, and we will have another look to the first step, actually, before moving on to the second step. You can see that we have multiple BFFs, and all of the BFF applications, they talk to the same set of microservices on the first step. So you can deduce that every request coming to SoundCloud platform, they end up on this set of microservices. So those microservices, they handle the 100% of the traffic that is coming to SoundCloud's platform. And because of this high load of traffic, and we call this layer our critical path. And there are two things that we need to make sure that we are doing on the critical path. First one is we not only have to scale those microservices up to a level where they can handle the 100% of the incoming traffic, also we need to over-provision them, because they are, SoundCloud's business is prone to traffic bursts, because someone uploads a really viral content to our platform, then this content creates a huge spike of incoming traffic. And this huge spike, the first place that it hits is the microservices on the critical path. So we need to be ready for this kind of unexpected situations, and also we are on call for those microservices, and we need to be very responsive to the incidents that are happening on those services. Next thing that we need to make sure that we have is handling the failures in a graceful manner. Because if we have a failure on the critical path, and if we don't handle this failure in a graceful way, then we are in trouble. Because if we start dropping requests on this layer, we can essentially take down the whole SoundCloud platform, including every application, every product that we have. This is definitely something we need to avoid. That's why we are handling the errors that are graceful. And how we are doing is that no matter what error happening on this layer, we always have a default fallback logic. And for example, we can take authenticator as an example. So if we cannot authenticate the incoming session, we say that, OK, I'm not able to authenticate this request, but take an anonymous session and try to do your operation with this anonymous session. And there are actually plenty of features that you can use on SoundCloud without logging in. And most important being playing a track. You don't need to log in to play a track on SoundCloud. So this kind of fallback implementations, they save us. So I think we can now move on to the second step. So second step is about aggregating data from microservices. And when our architecture was like this, that was a pretty easy operation. It was either the mothership or one of the microservices we have, and there were only a handful of those. But then as we wrote more microservices, responses of those services became more and more granular. So the response of a single microservice now wasn't satisfying the use case of the incoming request. That's why we needed to aggregate data over multiple microservices. And at this point, the most convenient place to put this aggregation logic was the BFF application itself. So we implemented it there, and soon after, we came across this. So another BFF application showed up into town. It uses the same resources and has a pretty similar aggregation logic. So we end up having code duplicates across our BFF implementations. So code duplication is tolerable in microservice architecture to some extent, but this was getting a bit out of beyond that extent. So we wanted to solve this. What we did was writing even more microservices that is responsible for aggregating data from other microservices. This kind of worked, but soon after we started hitting another problem, because at this time we never had any clear vision or structure for our microservices. As said, our production environment was like a dumping place, and the faster we started doing this, our architecture day by day was getting closer to this. So of course this was something that we wanted to avoid, so we wanted to give a structure to, or give a sense to what's going on there. And we did what we always do, we created more layers. So we created layers within the layers, and we created a layer called foundation layer that lives in the microservices layer. So this foundation layer, we created services there that has a really specific and clear definition of what they should be doing. So those services there, they are only responsible for providing very simple CRUD operations on the resources that they represent. For example, let's get tracks. Track service is creating a track, retrieving a track, updating and deleting. And anything fancier than this should go to another layer. And the most important thing on this layer is that those services don't talk to anyone at all except for their data source. So they are just a thin wrapper around their data sources. On top of this, we created value-added layer. Vast majority of our microservices, they live on this layer, and they implement the meat of the business logic. And their responsibility is that to go to the services on the foundation layer, fetch the necessary data, and kind of make some operations on it in order to satisfy the feature that they are implementing, and then send it back to the upper layer. Of course, it was inevitable for us to avoid talking to each other on this layer, so we allowed it. So on this layer, we still aggregate data from the services, from their peer services. This technically still leaves a gap for having circular dependencies and ending up with complex dependencies. But as long as we keep this structure in mind, as long as we know that a request should come from a BFF application, should go somewhere in the value-added layer, and should eventually end up somewhere in the foundation layer, this actually gives us a guidance. And when we are building features, we know which microservice to build and how to build it and where to put it. So this also, this is still work in progress. So there are exceptions like mothership. It doesn't fit anywhere, but this is becoming more and more useful for us. So I will talk about monitoring a bit. I picked this photo on purpose because the way those two people stare at creepily, it reminds me how we stare at our prom dashes, our dashboards during outages. So that was a photo chosen on purpose. So let's talk about graphite and statistics, because that was how we were doing this stuff when I first joined the company. But soon after, we moved to Prometheus. And Prometheus started as a side project of two engineers from our infrastructure team. And last year it was published, and now it is a hugely popular and I guess very successful open source monitoring tool. And many other companies, it's already grew out of SoundCloud, and many companies are already using it. Who knows actually Prometheus actually? Can you? Okay, this kind of proves, there are plenty of people, this proves the statement, so it is popular already. There were some design goals of Prometheus, and those were mainly about the problems that we came across with graphite and statistics, and they were the problems that Prometheus was trying to address. So I'll talk about those design goals briefly. So first of all, once we switched to microservices architecture, the amount of metrics data we needed to collect from our instances increased almost exponentially, because it used to be only one application, our mothership, that was exporting metrics data, but now there are hundreds or more than 100 microservices that are exporting metrics data. So we wanted to have a scalable way of collecting this data. And Stasi was able to scale, but it was really painful to operate it at this scale. So they wanted to come up with a scalable approach, and also it should be easy to operate, because we want our feature teams to own their monitoring tools as well. We don't want to have another monitoring team to set up and configure all the things. We want our backend developers to do that work by themselves, and because we want to reduce the dependency mapping between our team. So this was, those two were the main design goals of primitives. There are more things like multi-dimensional data model. This wasn't available on Graphite, and primitives wanted to provide a powerful query language in order to be able to make use of this multi-dimensional data model. So I will briefly explain how it works. You need two things. Obviously, at the first step, your primitive server and your microservice. And then you need two more things, which is a HTTP endpoint on your service that is responsible for exposing the metrics data that has been collected on this instance so far. And the very last step is to configure your primitives to start scraping data from this endpoint on a regular basis. So once this connection is done, you are ready to go and start querying the data on your primitive server. And setting up this HTTP endpoint is pretty straightforward, because primitives is providing client libraries on various languages. So as long as you use one of them, it's really a straightforward operation to get this endpoint up and running. And when it is up and running, it gives us some kind of metrics data that looks like this. So what primitives does is that it comes to this endpoint, it scrapes all the data, it parses out and stores it in its storage in this multi-dimensional fashion that I mentioned earlier, and we will talk about this later again. And then you can head over to your primitive server and start issuing queries. So, of course, on production, we have multiple of those, but primitives supports service discovery, so when you do a deployment and scale up new instances, they are automatically picked up. There's nothing very interesting here. And also, as said, this is how we set up our dashboards. At the moment, we are using a tool called PromDash, which is also provided by primitives, but now Grafana supports primitives, so you can use Grafana as well. And we'll come to a bit more interesting thing. So this is how we export metrics data from our instances. As you can see, on the top we define this metric, and then we define its dimensions. This is a counter at the moment, and when we are increasing that counter, we can assign custom values to those dimensions. And then while querying, we can write queries against those dimensions. So a query example is this. So this is basically telling me, give me all the requests that receive the response to this something different than 2xx, and show me their distribution by their service method and status. So this is a very typical query that we run for all of our BFF applications. What is actually happening is that, so we have a BFF application and it talks to multiple microservices. We want to know which microservices return the non-successful response to our BFF application, and we want to know their distribution, so which services sent this non-successful response, and what was the HTTP method, what was the actual status code that we received. Is it a redirection, or is it a 400, or internal error, so whatever. And another interesting graph we have is this. Sometimes we deploy different implementations for the same microservice to production, so they still provide the same interface, so nothing is breaking the consumers, but they have different internal implementations, and we want to know which one is performing better. So what we do is that we export their Git revision to their performance metrics, and what we are looking at here is the CPU usage of two different implementations. So we can easily see which one is using less CPU, which one is performing better. So this is as well a very useful graph for us. And another interesting thing we do is that primitives allows you to compare the values that you have at the moment to the values that you had in the past. So what we are looking at is a latency graph of a microservice, and we are comparing its latency values to the latency that we had yesterday and we had a week ago. So this is also very useful because it shows us if we are making any progress or not. So I will talk about distributed tracing very briefly. So distributed tracing is another tool that we use for monitoring or the behavior of our microservices. Distributed tracing is tracing an interaction that transaction that happened or executed over a large, complicated set of distributed systems. And the microservices architecture fits very well to this definition. And in this definition, transaction is an incoming request. So what this tool is giving us, given a request that we have at hand, what microservices that it has been through, and how much time did it spend on each of the microservices. So we use a tool called Zipkin, and its UI looks like this. And it gives this information that is specific to a single request. So the latencies of microservices, we can get this data from our monitoring tool as well. But then this data, this information that monitoring tool is giving is always aggregated over multiple data points. So if you want to, if you are debugging an edge case that is something weird happening for only single request, then Zipkin is the tool that we are using. So lastly, I wanted to talk about a project that we call Service Level Objectives. I'm personally fascinated or excited about this project. And this is not fully implemented yet. It is still work in progress. But since I believe this something will be very useful, I wanted to mention that project as well. So over time, by using our monitoring tool and Zipkin, we came to realize that some services are actually not performing as well as we hope them to be, or as well as our expectations. So what we want to do is that we want to have a clear visibility of what services are not performing well, and we want to have this visibility. And because at the moment it is really manual labor. If you want to find a service that is underperforming, we need to go to our monitoring tool and Zipkin and make some queries, and it takes time. So we want to automate this, and we want to have the results of this work available for each of our microservices. So what we are doing is that we have a file called manifest.json, which is by convention is added to the root level of each of the code bases we have. And on this file, what we define is the objectives of this service. So what we are defining is that we are defining the acceptable error rate, the maximum acceptable error rate for this service, and maximum acceptable latency of this service. So as long as the service is performing within those boundaries, everything is all good. But if this service is not performing within those boundaries, we consider that this service is underperforming. And at the end of the month, we make a calculation. We get the ratio of how much or how long it has been performing well over the time that it has worked over the full month. And then if this ratio doesn't meet the ratio that we are expecting here, then it is time to raise a red flag. Okay, we need to prioritize some work on this service. And we want to make this result available for each of our microservices, and we want to make it visible to the whole company. So which tool is the place to put this data? It is, of course, services directory. It all came back. So we want to implement, we want to do yet another integration to the services directory, and I think this will increase the importance of this tool, because I personally think that this data or information will be valuable to most of our engineering organization. So you can congratulate me. I'm actually done with everything I have, but I will recap first. So what did we talk about? We talked about knowledge sharing, how we spread the knowledge around our microservices. We talked about service directory. And then we talked about our architecture, how it evolved, how we switched to and why we switched to BFF applications, and how we started structuring our microservices. And the last thing we talked about, monitoring. The tools that we used, the tools that we dumped, and our future project for keeping the performance of our microservices in check. I'll leave you with some further reading. Backstage is our technical blog. You can check it out. There are also different links from our colleagues and also other external companies. And we have been heavily inspired by Netflix's architecture during this transition. And also, as I said, there are more writing about BFF architecture from external people. So thank you very much for listening to me.
Okay, so thank you very much, Bora. We've got a couple of minutes for questions. One question at the front.
Hi, Yes, thank you. When you say you have a lot of different backends for frontends, do you ever get to the? Do you have experience that you need to like make the same change to multiple of those when there's a change in business process or security or something?
Yeah, that happened before actually, and this is a bit of a. Yeah, that happened before, and I was actually personally involved in that kind of work. So what we did was I paired with a colleague of mine. We went to each of our BFFs, and we went to each of the. We changed the integration of a single microservice on each of those BFFs, and this was a bit of a manual labor. But that happens. I mean, I think we need to decide how much of it is tolerable. So far, I've been involved in a couple of that kind of works, but. I guess, we are trying to strike the balance. I mean, there are ways to avoid it. Like, you can put it on another service or yet another service or in a library. But libraries didn't work very well for us as well because they created coupling. So, that happens. And it is hard to know when to start extracting that kind of stuff. Yeah, I hope that answers.
I have two questions. One is said you autoscale.
Oh, there.
Do you autoscale on premise or in a cloud? And the other dimension of the question would be, do you encrypt any of the requests?
I didn't get the first part, actually. You can keep the mic.
You said you scale your services. Do you do it like with an on-premise solution or do you scale out within a cloud?
At the moment, it is under construction at the moment. So we historically started using something called Bazooka, which is an internal project. It was going to be open source at one point, but I think we decided not to because there are so many other solutions which are kind of better. So at the moment, we are using our internal tool, and it is giving us a command line interface that is pretty much like the Heroku. So you can just say, scale this up, or build this image, put this image on production, and now scale this up. So that hopefully answers the first part. And
Do you encrypt or authenticate any of the internal requests?
No, actually, because like everything in the microservices land, we deem this area as secure because everything is every kind of security encryption or whatever that is related to that kind of stuff. They happen on the perimeter on the BFF applications. So whatever comes in, we assume that it is sanitized and secure. Okay. By the way, is it possible to have the slides on the screen? Because I had some funny GIFs and stuff. isn't anyone looking after it? OK, anyway, so I think we can continue with the questions if there are any more. There is one more.
Any more questions, anyone?
Yeah, just. So one question. On the front-end side, for the desktop, how do you...
Okay, thank you very much.
How do you compose the application there? Because it looks like to me that for the desktop, all the requests go to the BFF layer. So I was just wondering how you decompose the different bounding contexts on the desktop application.
So as far as I understood, the question is about how do we compose the responses of microservices on the BFF layer. Is that correct?
Yeah. It was more about on the front end how you decompose the different things because they are also separated, right? Like the microservices.
Yeah, that's a good question. And to my shame, even though I worked on front end on the website, I actually don't know because it changed a lot. Since the time I stopped working there. But at the moment, I'm not sure if we decompose it. Yeah, actually we do. And yeah, this is really specific to how we use backbone and stuff on the front end. And actually, we build a kind of a wrapper layer around backbone. And when it gets the request, when it gets the response, for example, you get the track, and this track has a sub response in it, which is the user, then our framework, the front end framework, is automatically picking up the sub resources and it is caching them. So this is the best answer I can give you at the moment, but this may have changed, and I'm usually wrong about this kind of stuff. So hopefully that answers now. But we can talk more offline. I can put you in contact with the right people. Yeah. Oh, okay, there are the slides, just a second. This was supposed to be the answer to the first question, but I guess I did better than that. And we had more, and this was for the second question. Thank you, whoever was asking. It's fine. I have more. Okay, this was this is the correct answer for the front end actually. So, okay, but we can continue. I have one more actually.
So when you moved away from the mothership, did you also like stop contacting the mothership for the same kind of requests? Or was the API was still talking to the mothership from the app?
When you say API, do you mean the new implementation of public API?
So you had the mothership on one side and all the microservices on one side. So once all the microservices came from the mothership, did you like stop serving those old requests from the mothership instead started talking to the new one?
Yeah, definitely. So that is what we did on the BFF layer. So we were getting the requests on the BFF layer, and we are kind of investigating what this request needs. So some functionality are moved out of mothership already, and for that function, we go to the microservice. For the rest of the stuff, we may still need to talk to mothership codebase, but we do two separate requests and then combine them back into the BFF,
just
in the BFF layer.
Small follow-up question on that. So you showed us the last bit where you like compared like the performance metrics over a month. How does it look like for your mothership? Because since you have both of those things, does it make a difference at all?
Yeah, that's another good question. That's a tough one, so you deserve this one. So yeah, I'll put this question together with the question about the front end. So, by the way, this, I wasn't supposed to show it. So in order to answer that question. So first of all, I didn't work on mothership since we moved to microservices, because already most of the functions or the important ones are on microservices. And I'm sure someone in the team or in the company did that comparison, but I personally did not do. And I don't know, like, from the mothership, it's a Ruby code base, and I don't know if we are exporting metrics to Prometheus from our mothership. I'm not sure if that is implemented, but if it is implemented, in theory, that is possible. We can do that, but I don't have personal experience with that. I hope that answers. Yeah, maybe. Any other questions? You can let me know if there isn't, because I will show you the next slide. Okay, I guess that's all right. So, there's one more. Please go on.
How much of your mothership is still left in your stack? I understand you still have it. Like, how much is left? Yeah. And what's your thought on whether you can get rid of it completely or whether you have any plans in this direction?
I think there is still a couple of hundred of instances running. So there is still plenty of stuff there. And yeah, we are working every day to extract stuff out of it. And from what I heard from our engineering leadership, I think it won't ever be possible to get rid of it completely. There will still be some kind of functionality that is living there, and it won't be critical enough for our business to create a microservice for it. So we'll just keep using it. Okay, if there isn't any more questions, I will show you the last slide. Ah, this one. So whatever we do, we are all doomed. That was the key takeaway of this presentation. So.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So there's going to be a break now, and I hope to see you back at 3:05 for the lightning talks.